Random House Audio presents The Victory Lab, The Secret Science of Winning Campaigns by Sasha Issenberg. Read for you by Michael Goldstrom. Prologue. How to Win an Election Without Anyone Knowing. The ads aired by the two candidates in the 2010 Colorado U.S. Senate race told the story of the ideological war that defined that midterm election. Michael Bennett, a freshman Democrat appointed to replace a man who had become one of Barack Obama's cabinet secretaries, was deeply in hock to a liberal White House. Tea Party Republican challenger Ken Buck was, or so went the punditry and Bennett's attacks, too conservative for the moderate suburbanizing state. Meanwhile, 1 million letters being delivered to Democratic-leaning Coloradoans in the last days of the race made no mention of either candidate, their allegiances, or the issues that separated them. They lacked any allusion to the ideological split riving the nation, or reference to the policy consequences of a change in party control of the Senate. The folded pieces of laser-printed white paper were designed to be ugly, with a return address referring to a sender whose name voters were unlikely to recognize. The sender thanked the recipient by first name for having voted in 2008, and then said she looked forward to being able to express such gratitude again after the coming elections. The letter, dispassionate in tone and startlingly personal in content, might have inspired most recipients to dispatch it to a trash can with no strong feeling other than being oddly unsettled by its arrival. It was not only in Colorado where communications in the last days before the 2010 elections seemed out of whack with such a feral season in American politics. Across the country on the Sunday night before the election, millions of Democrats received an email from Obama's seemingly dormant campaign apparatus, Organizing for America, with a gently worded reminder that they had made a commitment to vote in this election, and that the time has come to make good on that commitment. Think about when you'll cast your vote and how you'll get there. The voters who received either the Colorado letter or the Organizing for America message had likely never encountered anything like them before. At a moment when many candidates, ad men, pundits, and organizers thought that the way to get their allies to the polls was to implore them through television ads to consider the election's high stakes and respond in kind, these tactics, designed to go undetected by media coverage, aimed to push buttons that many voters didn't even know they had. The people who had scripted the messages and carefully selected their recipients aimed to exploit eternal human vulnerabilities, such as the desire to fit in or not to be seen as a liar, in order to turn layabouts into voters. The man who had sent the million letters in white envelopes did the quick math after the Colorado election from his post thousands of miles away. Hal Malchow was a middle-aged Mississippian who had spent his life conniving new ways to win elections, except for a brief detour into securities law that ended when he realized that writing the contracts to guard against complex financial schemes was less fun than trying to hatch them. Now he was playing a different angle, and calculated that the psychological influence he had exerted through his letters would improve turnout among recipients by 2.5%. That would mean that his language had created 25,000 new voters, most of them carefully selected to be likely votes for the incumbent. Bennett had lagged Buck for much of the year and had never approached the 50% threshold that many experts say is necessary in pre-election polls for an incumbent to expect victory. There was further evidence of a gap in partisan enthusiasms. At the time the polls opened, 74,000 fewer Democrats had returned their early vote ballots than Republicans. But on Election Day, something was pushing Bennett even with Buck. And by the time Malchow turned in for the night, the two candidates were separated by only hundreds of votes. The next morning, he awoke to good news from the West. Bennett had pulled ahead of Buck and was on his way to winning the race by 15,000 votes. His victory would help to keep the Senate in Democratic control. Malchow was having fun. Colorado was one of the rare sources of cheer for Democrats in an otherwise disastrous set of midterm elections in 2010. Party-wise men were eager to mine grand lessons from the Rockies. If only they could figure out what made Colorado resist a national conservative wave, they could use Bennett's strategy as a model for Obama's re-election 2 years later. The Bennett thing was pretty instructive, Obama's chief strategist, David Axelrod, told the National Journal in a postmortem. The contrast he drew with Buck was very meaningful. The people who explain politics for a living, the politicians themselves, their advisors, the media who cover them, love to reach tidy conclusions like this one. Elections are decided by charismatic personalities, strategic maneuvers, the power of rhetoric, the zeitgeist of the political moment. The explainers cloak themselves in loose-fitting theories because they offer a narrative comfort, unlike the more honest acknowledgement that elections hinge on the motivations of millions of individual human beings and their messy, illogical, often unknowable psychologies. In fact, Bennett could have won the Senate seat because of major demographic changes and ideological fault lines around delicate cultural issues, or because of a single letter that exerted a subtle dose of peer pressure on its recipients, or hundreds of other factors, big and small, that played a part in changing people's minds or getting them to vote. The political craft thrives on that ambiguity. It allows just about anyone involved to take credit for good results or attribute blame for poor ones, confident of never being proven wrong. After a positive result on election night, everything a winning campaign did looks brilliant. When a campaign loses, consultants usually blame the candidate or the moment, and there rarely seem to be professional consequences for those who had set the strategy or tactics. Longevity, as well as the aura of wisdom that comes from it, is a political operative's most valued trait. Over a generation, helping Americans choose their leaders has grown into a $6 billion per year industry. But the new profession hums along on a mixture of tradition and inertia, unable to learn from its successes or its failures. The tools available to campaign operatives can do little to explain what makes someone vote, and few of the people toiling inside campaign war rooms seem disturbed by this gap in their knowledge. It's probably the only industry in the world where there's no market research, says Dave Carney, the top strategist on the launch of Texas Governor Rick Perry's presidential campaign. Most things are done with only one check, says Steve Rosenthal, a Democratic consultant who works closely on campaigns with many of the left's top interest groups, people's guts. The unheralded arrival of the gently threatening letters in Colorado mailboxes marked the maturation of a tactical revolution against that kind of gut politics. The first stirrings had come a decade earlier, in the wake of the 2000 presidential vote, which shifted on election night from a contest between electoral strategists to a tussle among lawyers. What seemed at the time to be a low-stakes election would have a major effect on the way campaigns were waged. The narrow, almost accidental quality of George W. Bush's victory, decided by 537 votes in Florida, or really just one on the Supreme Court, provoked a reexamination of where votes come from. Seemingly small boosts of 2 or 3 percentage points quickly became indispensable components of a victory formula, and the intellectual hierarchy of thinking about campaigns changed accordingly. Turnout, the unsexy practice of mobilizing known supporters to vote, could no longer be dismissed by campaign leadership as little more than a logistically demanding civics project to be handled by junior staff or volunteers. Campaigns could not obsess only over changing minds through mass media. Many strategists had been believers that big things are all that matter in campaigns, The big events, the big TV spots, the debates, the convention and the VP pick, says Adrian Gray, who worked in the Bush White House and on both of Bush's campaigns. After 2000, for the first time, a lot of people who shared that sentiment started to believe that there is a lot that can be done on the margins.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.